All right. It's a small group today, so I hope you guys can talk. But I think I would love to actually start out by hearing Rahel and Ramzi a little bit more about you. If you're open to telling me a little bit more, it'd be helpful. And we can just have a conversation. This is going to be recorded, but I'd love to know who's in the room so we can have a discussion if that's okay. Okay. No problem. So we're going to get started. My name's Danielle. You may have read about the cap-exempt H-1B. You may have read about the Build Fellowship before, but I'm going to tell you more about the story behind how this works. So, I started Open Avenues Foundation about 6 years ago, and the intention is to demonstrate that foreign nationals are actually able to continue to add value to the United States when they build careers here and contribute to our future workforce. So we intentionally have built programming that not only innovates within immigration legislation to open pathways, but to also demonstrate that the contributions to our society as we have foreign nationals stay here. So I want to, ensure that everybody understands about the program itself. You may be here because you have lost the lottery. You may be here because you are outside the United States and want to enter the United States. But either way, I think that there's a lot to be said about learning and being here to understand your options. And that's a huge part of why we do what we do. I see someone is raising their hand, so I'd love for you to jump in if you want to. Rahel, is that you? Okay. Amazing. And one moment, I'm just pulling this presentation back up. I will tell you a little bit about myself because I think it's interesting as we as you get to know the Build Fellowship, to know that I actually started the Build Fellowship with my father, who is an immigration attorney. Jeff Goldman was the first, he started the country's first cap-exempt H-1B model back in 2014. He was working with the state of Massachusetts, the government, to actually design what it could look like to leverage a cap-exempt H-1B program in the United States and how this could work. So everything you'll hear today is not new. It's not, it's innovative, but it's also been around for years as we've, worked to make sure that we are compliant and working within legislation to ensure that, everything we do is above board and that it really does open these solutions for everyone. So I am going to start this presentation and we will get going. So as many of you know, the H-1B visa is the most common work visa in the United States. And today it's actually just a few months after the fiscal year 2025 lottery. And the lottery for the H-1B visa takes place once per year. Really frustrating for folks that are outside the United States and have a job offer in the United States and want to come work here throughout the year because you have to wait for the March lottery to even begin to register to potentially get selected in the lottery. And then on October 1st, the new fiscal year in the United States, you can enter. And the lottery is capped at 85,000 every year. And this past year, this data is from the previous year, but 2025, we just got the data that 30% of individuals were selected. The good news this year was that there was far fewer counts of fraud. It was fraudulent to have you be entered by multiple companies to have many, many chances into the lottery. It's very legitimate for you as a person to be entered by multiple companies, but you as a human will only have one chance in the lottery, and it's done by passport numbers. And that's how USCIS now, as of January 2024, will conduct the lottery every year. Every person gets one shot at winning the H-1B. So for companies, this is frustrating because companies want to retain talent. For foreign nationals, this is frustrating because there's a 30% chance that you can stay here. And for any of you on the call that went to school in the United States, this is even more frustrating because you've invested a lot into coming here and building your career here and launching it here and to do OPT here and invest in a company. And to come up against this roadblock can be incredibly challenging. There are a few options to consider. I'm not here saying that the cap-exempt H-1B is the only option, but because the H-1B is the most common option, it's because of the criteria. There are other opportunities, but not everybody at such a volume as the H-1B falls within that criteria. So the O-1 is an extraordinary ability visa. Many of you may have heard of the O-1, you need to meet 3 of the 8 criteria to prove that you are extraordinary in the United States. An L-1 is if you work for a multinational company and you've worked abroad for 1 year for that company. A TN visa is available for folks from Canada or Mexico. F-1 CPT, you may have heard, and I always get the question, what should I go back to school for another degree in an F-1 first day CPT program that offers you CPT on the first day that you start school? They've been cracked down upon in the past, and there's been lots of counts of fraudulent programs out there. So many lawyers will say, don't go that route, but it is totally a possibility. And then another option is the cap-exempt H-1B. And our question is, are you willing to work 5 hours per week training U.S. students in your field of expertise to stay in the United States on a cap-exempt H-1B. So cap-exempt H-1Bs can be sponsored any time of year outside of the lottery system, and individuals that are employed part-time by a cap-exempt H-1B organization for just 5 hours per week can actually have any U.S. employer file a concurrent cap-exempt H-1B. That means you can have legally 2 H-1Bs in the United States. And as long as there's a part-time cap-exempt H-1B that you have approved, you can go to any U.S. employer, Amazon, Google, a startup company, your own company, and file a full-time cap-exempt H-1B so that you can be working outside of the lottery system on an H-1B visa. The only 4 organizations in the United States that can actually sponsor a cap-exempt H-1B are universities, government research organizations, nonprofit research organizations, and nonprofits affiliated with a university. So if any of you on this call today are interested in going and working for one of these organizations full-time, awesome. You don't have to enter the lottery, and you can go work as a professor at a university or for a hospital that's a nonprofit research organization. But if you want to go into the private sector because you're a scientist and you don't want to work for a hospital system, but you actually want to work for a biotech company, or you don't want to work for a university and you would like to work for that biotech company, you can work 5 hours per week part-time for one of these cap-exempt organizations and have them sponsor you. And it will allow the biotech company to sponsor you in a cap-exempt H-1B. Now, the challenge here is getting one of these types of organizations to actually say, okay, you can work part-time and we'll go through the sponsorship process for your cap-exempt H-1B, right? So what we did was we built a solution for this. It's called the Build Fellowship. And Build Fellows actually work part-time for one of the nonprofits in our network, which is affiliated with universities. Because if we go back one slide, you'll see that nonprofits affiliated with a university are one of these 4 types of cap-exempt organizations. So the Build Fellowship has nonprofits that are affiliated with universities. That company is actually used to nominate global talent like yourselves for Build Fellowships so that you can work part-time 5 hours per week in a Build Fellowship program, actually training students at these partner schools. So we hire foreign nationals into Build Fellowship positions within your field of expertise. So we have Build Fellows that are software developers. We have Build Fellows that are data scientists or graphic designers or finance professionals. And you work 5 hours per week within that field to train students at our partner schools while working full-time for your US employer. Open Avenues Foundation has been doing this for a long time. We now have other nonprofits that we're partnered with in our network, but we have sponsored 175 foreign nationals through this fellowship program. We've trained 1,000 students. We have 140 company partners that have come to us for solutions for their talent. And it's really exciting to see the foreign nationals able to stay here and build careers. So Open Avenues Foundation is one of these nonprofits. George Washington University has partnered with us on a program, and Dream Venture Labs is another nonprofit in Boston. The George Washington University program is in DC. The Dream Venture Labs program is Boston preferred, but it's also remote, and Open Avenues is fully remote. So if you have at least a bachelor's degree or the equivalent of a bachelor's degree, and you have a couple years of work experience, and you're willing to mentor or work with students and peer, or, you know, you have experience working with students or peers where we know and we would feel confident putting you in front of students in this fellowship, you can do our program. We look for a benefactor. Now, what is a benefactor? And if any of you have filled out the form on our website and tried to start this process, you will know what a benefactor is from the description, but it's there's two types. On one hand, you can never pay for your, well, for both types, you can never pay for your own H-1B in the United States. And what that means is that our fellowship program, which does include sponsorship, should not be paid by you personally. So either, and the most common scenario is scenario A, you have a company that wants to keep you in the United States and wants to support your career because maybe you've been working there for a long time or you have a unique skill set and they need it. You can have them nominate you for this program and they will pay the fees and the financial commitment. That is the most straightforward. We've been doing it for years. We've also launched a new program where if you yourself want to pay for the program because your company says we're not going to pay for it, but sure, if you're in cap-exempt H-1B status, we'll sponsor you for a concurrent H-1B, or you have a lot to add to your field, but you're looking for a job or you've been laid off and you're looking for your next job and you're running out of status, a good solution is to find a benefactor to pay for this program. This could be your own company that you start. It could be a family company or another company that's willing to support your fellowship program, but it can't be you. So that's the key here. The timeline for how, and we'll go into the pricing later for what benefactors and what that financial commitment is, but I want to talk through the timeline of this. So with the evaluation and the contracting, it takes about 2 to 3 weeks. We go through a whole due diligence process. We want to make sure that you are eligible for this program, that you are qualified for an H-1B. We'll have the contract signed by your company. That takes a little bit of time for us to go back and forth if they have any edits. And then once we sign that contract, we start on petition development. Now, this is a quick process. If you know anything about premium processing, it's a really awesome tool because it requires that we get a response in 15 days. So we develop our petitions, we file the cap-exempt H-1B, and we get an approval within 6 to 8 weeks. As soon as we get an approval for your fellowship, it immediately allows for your full-time employer to file a full-time visa, cap-exempt, outside of the cap of $85,000. So that takes about 1 week. So in total, we're looking at about 10 weeks, 11 weeks for you to get into the program and continue working for your employer. And that means you should really be thinking about getting into our process at least, 3 months before your expiration dates. Now, if you're already past that, that's okay. Definitely reach out. We have on a record of 20 days of getting this done. So we won't try to beat it because it's a little stressful, but it's certainly something that's possible. So what are you doing for 5 hours per week in this fellowship program? Our Build Fellows are working to actually launch projects within your field. And so these are the types of projects that our fellows launch, right? We have an individual who is a who works in biotechnology, right? And he's working with students to build a pipeline to segment single cell immunofluorescent images. And that's a really niche project, obviously. But what's cool about that is students actually get to learn about the technical skills needed to go work for a company like Camp 4 Therapeutics. And Ollie, who is one of our fellows, leads that project, and he's very comfortable leading that project because this is what he does all day long. And so it's a win-win. Ollie is managing students, learning how to explain basic concepts in a very complex field of immunofluorescent imaging. And the students are getting really awesome work experience. So it's an awesome program that we run, and these projects are really appreciated by our partner schools. So what does it take to actually join the program? Once you apply on our website through the nomination form, you can fill it out yourself or your company can fill it out. We charge an $18,000 initiation fee, which covers the cost of the visa, the petitioning, the fellowship onboarding, premium processing, government filing fees. Everything is included in that $15,000 to $18,000. Ideally, you know, if a company nominates multiple employees, that's when we can lower the price. But most companies have one employee in this program, and it's $18,000. We also have a monthly fee of $1,300 once you start the program. The reason we have this monthly fee is because everybody's in the program for a different amount of time. So some individuals are in our program for just 6 months, which is our minimum, because you might win the lottery and you will actually exit our program in October when the new fiscal year starts. Some people stay in our program until they leave because they get a green card approved. There's a varying amount of time. We have an average of about a year and a half. The salary share is not a fee, but it is included in our financial commitment because it's actually a portion of the total salary that you get from a full-time employer. So the full-time employer has offered you $100,000 in base compensation. Maybe about $10,000 of that will come through the Build Fellowship program, and you will get that $10,000 from the Build Fellowship and then $90,000 from your employer. So it's just a breakdown of the total compensation you've been offered. That's so we stay compliant and pay you the fair prevailing wage. And I want to note that, you know, for Build Fellows who enter this program, of course, this is about getting a cap-exempt H-1B, and it's about, you know, creating this pathway that didn't exist for you to build your career in the United States. But as Marja has said, it's also about helping students who are eager to learn and eager to build their careers start in the United States. And our fellows, I talk to a lot of them about this. They really do get so much out of this program when they are, you know, teaching students and spending that time. It's like volunteer time where you're actually working within your field to train up students. And many of the students are diverse, low income. They are looking for career launching opportunities. That's why they come to the Build Fellowship program to sign up for these types of projects. So that's what I wanted to say. And I think someone may have joined late, but I want to make sure we have some time to answer any questions. So you can ask in the Q&A, you can raise your hand. I'm happy to answer anything that you have. I did promise a discussion today. See, I'm too fast at this presentation. I've been doing it for so many years. Anil, you have a question? Let me see I think you have to unmute yourself. Anil, are you able to speak or no?
Yes, hello. Thank you again for joining us and giving us so much information, and thank you for your time and consideration. So I would like to ask you something about the hospitality industry. Is it included in the H-1B visa or not? Because I had already C-1D visa and I work in the cruise ship. And I would like to relocate to United States.
Okay.
So is it possible to change my statute from C1D visa to H1B visa?
Do you have a degree, at least a bachelor's degree?
Yeah, I have it.
What is the degree in?
It's bachelor, and I've got my hospitality administration diploma.
So it's a bachelor's. What is the bachelor's in? What field?
The field is in administration, business administration.
Business administration. So
right. It
is possible that you could do an H-1B if we can find a good case to be made for a business degree. Because to have a really good case for an H-1B, you have to show that you meet one of the specialty occupations in the United States. So the Department of Labor has a list of specialty occupations, and it's on the FLC. It's actually called the OOH handbook. And I can drop a link in here. Actually, you can't see the link, but if you look up OOH handbook specialty occupations, you'll be able to see the different types of occupations in the United States. Now, if you find an occupation that is what you're working in, you have to have a degree that is related to the field in which you are working. So business is actually not a specialty occupation. It's too broad. Finance is a specialty occupation. Marketing is a specialty occupation. Analytics is a specialty occupation. So in your business degree, if you had a few marketing courses or you had a few finance courses where we could prove that you actually have enough coursework in your bachelor's degree to meet one of those specialty occupations, that would be a good case for an H-1B. But you working in hospitality, we'd need to understand there's so many different types of roles within hospitality. We'd need to get pretty specific. Is it operations, marketing, finance? What part of hospitality are you working in? Well, and yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much for this information. So our part is really different. We have a lot of many different responsibilities inside the ship. Like, you know, we are responsible about the marketing. We are responsible about the accelerating department of the reservation, and we make excursion, and we are responsible about the safety, the security, everything inside the ship. We are responsible on it. So I've got my my diploma in another special department is the marketing business management. And the other one, I took it from Allison Hospitality Industry. And I've got another diploma. I don't know, is it existing in America or no? So for that reason, I ask about this details. But I would like to ask about the statute of the visa. Is it possible to change it or not? So because a lot of many different people told me, no, that's not possible because you have got your C1D visa, and C1D visa allows you only to work in the ship or in the aircrafts. So for that reason, I'm really confused what to do exactly. Do I have to apply in EB3 program or H1B program or H2B program? So it's really makes me very confused about that.
Sure.
Thank you for your answer.
Yeah. So I'm, you know, you're going to have to speak. We will definitely need to have you speak to an immigration attorney about this. But the reality is you can always change status. You can file a change of status. So unless there's a, you know, with a J-1 visa, for example, there's a home residency requirement where you have to go home after you're in a J-1 for some countries. Unless there's a requirement like that, you can always do a change of status petition. We file change of status from L1 to H-1B. We file change of status from J-1 to H-1B. So you file a change of status, you just have to qualify for the H-1B. The law firm we partner with is called Goldman and Partners Immigration Law. That's my father's law firm. You can ask for Jeff. His email is jeff@gpimmigration.com.
Just let me write it, please. Can you spell it again?
Yeah, it's Jeff, Jeff at gpimmigration.com.
That's GP immigration.
Hey Vivek, how are you?
Hi, Daniel.
All right.
Nice
Thank
to.
you so much. I appreciate your information. Thank you. That's so kind.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Hi, Daniel. Nice to meet you. I've been following you on LinkedIn. Sorry, I joined a little late. I mean, I joined late. So I'm interested in teaching, and I did follow your LinkedIn post, and you had mentioned that you hire foreign nationals to join open avenues as part-time employees to lead educational programs. And I am interested in teaching math or computer science, and but I'm not entirely clear. I have a degree in mathematics, statistics, and computer science, and an analytics degree in US. Can you elaborate on how the Bill Fellowship can sponsor H-1B cap, and how I can work for you, and how does that work? I'm not fully clear.
The problem is I went through the presentation in the first 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
I'll tell you, I'll give you a summary. So the Build Fellowship is a part-time employment opportunity for you to work and train students within your field. It sounds like you have enough degrees to qualify for an H-1B, whether it's mathematics or analytics. So you're qualified. It's about who's going to support your fellowship, because usually we only hire foreign nationals for 5 hours a week. These are part-time positions. The intention is not to only work for us, it's to work for a full-time employer. The reason that people work in our fellowship program is to go work full-time somewhere else. And so, but you need a visa to do that. And so many companies will say, well, you can't work for us part-time because you have to enter the lottery, and it doesn't work because the lottery only selects 30% of people. And so the option here is that you find a company that is willing to pay for the fellowship. It's $18,000 and $1,300 per month once you're in the program for up to 3 years, or extendable, but you know, you can leave after 6 months. It's variable with cost, but certainly it's an expense. They have to want to invest in you. The other way to do this is if you personally have a company. You might have your own consulting firm. You might have, you know, you might start your own company. You might be a founder. You might have a family that has a company. You can have the company support your fellowship, but you cannot pay for the fellowship yourself. If you have someone, you know, your person in your personal network or your own company to sponsor this fellowship, you can then go pitch to an employer that you are available for full-time work, and you can be sponsored for a cap-exempt H-1B. So it is valuable in that way.
Oh God. So I'm currently employed at Deloitte Consulting, and I'm working as a IT consultant. And so if I form like my own company and get that work out.
Yes, absolutely. If you start your own consulting firm, you're a consultant, you know how to do it. If you start your own consulting firm, your consulting firm can certainly pay the fees for the fellowship.
And how does, so if I pay the fee, monthly fee to the Build Fellowship program, how does that work? How do I get the work visa? I'm still
the Build Fellowship
mm-hmm.
runs out of nonprofits that are affiliated with universities, which means they're
mm-hmm.
cap exempt. They can always sponsor H-1Bs. And so if you work as a fellow, you can be sponsored at any time for a part-time cap-exempt H-1B. Now, you would have to know that you have a full-time employer that would be willing to sponsor your full-time cap-exempt H-1B once you're in status. You know, you could, I have someone, you know, a lot of like smaller companies are fine with this. If you tell them, hey, I have a cap-exempt H-1B because I'm doing this fellowship program, they would say, great. We're going to sponsor the concurrent H-1B. It's so easy. The next day after they file, you can start working for them. It's no problem.
Mm-hmm.
For Deloitte, I don't know. I don't know like what they would say if you went to them and said, hey, I'm thinking of doing this fellowship program.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm in it,
mm-hmm.
I will be in cap-exempt H-1B status. Are you willing to then sponsor my full-time cap-exempt H-1B?
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if they will support me like this because we do have like, I mean, Deloitte does have an immigration group, but they only support filing H-1B on March, the normal H-1Bs on every end of March, and they support green card thereafter based on my H-1B
right.
select.
And what's but because they do sponsor H-1Bs, this is no different. Like this is, they would be paying the same price
mm-hmm.
because you would be taking care of the fees if you had your own company.
Got it. When I work for the Build Fellowship, what are my duties there in like every you mentioned like I have to work 5 hours a week or something
yeah,
like
that. Yeah, it's on your own time. You work with students and you launch projects within your field. So if you work in mathematics, you'd launch mathematics projects for students.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you'd be able to actually, you know, show them like key skills within the space and come up with projects that they would be able to complete.
Got it. Yeah, I'm interested in teaching math, computer science, statistics. I don't have any, I don't expect any money or I don't have any constraints, budget constraints on that. I'm not clear as to how I can convince my organization to fight. I don't
because understand. The rule is if you're in cap exempt H-1B status, then any U.S. employer is able to immediately file a cap exempt H-1B for you immediately. So if you would have to get them to basically say, if I change status to cap exempt H-1B through this fellowship, are you willing to file an H-1B for me? They already file H-1Bs. So the ask,
yes, they do. Yeah.
So the ask is that, okay, you usually only do this in October, but if I get into cap exempt H-1B status in June, are you willing to sponsor me for a concurrent cap exempt H-1B? I say concurrent because it means that it's on top of the cap exempt H-1B you would have through the Build Fellowship.
I'm not able to fully follow this. Maybe.
Okay, I'm going to have to ask you to watch the, because you missed the presentation.
Exactly. Yes.
So I'm going to have you watch the recording.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'll go through that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Baguma, do you have a question?
I studied the Bachelor of Arts in economics. Where do I belong here in H-1B?
What did you say?
I have a bachelor's degree in arts and economics.
Okay.
Where do I belong here in H-1B?
If you have a bachelor's in economics, you could get an H-1B.
I could get it.
If you have a job in that requires an economics degree.
Yes. I do.
You have a job.
Yeah.
Okay. That could be a good case for an H-1B.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Srivali, you have a question?
Yes, can you hear me?
I can, yes.
Yeah, I'm currently working as a software developer, and I've done my master's here in US, and I was not picked up in the H-1B lottery. So I understand the system of concurrent H-1Bs. I can maybe ask my employer for applying on my behalf.
Yep.
The only question is, how will I be able to get that cap-exempt H-1B job? Will you be able to help me in getting that, or how does that work?
Yes. The whole point here is that the Build Fellowship is the cap-exempt H-1B job.
Okay.
So the Build Fellowship is run out of a nonprofit that is affiliated with universities, which is cap-exempt. The Build Fellowship positions are cap-exempt positions, and we file cap-exempt H-1B visas for anybody who is in the Build Fellowship.
Okay. I have a couple of questions I want to ask. Let's say, how can I apply? The first one is, how can I apply for this Build Fellowship? When I was trying to fill out the form, it was asking for sponsorship and funding, which I currently don't have. So how can I start with the application?
Well, you should definitely fill it out because you have a company. So you need to go, you have a company. That are they willing to sponsor your H-1B?
They would sponsor my H-1B, which happens in March. I'm not sure if they would be willing to sponsor the H-1B, which we would be doing for the cap-exempt H-1B.
Right, but you should put them in here in that form, and you should go and fill out that self-nomination.
Okay.
And then you'll get materials sent to
okay.
you that will help you talk to your employer.
Got it. Great. Also, one more question. So how long does this process take? Because my EAD ends on July 4th.
Yeah, it's about 6 to 8 weeks. So we'd want to get
Six.
Rolling.
Okay, great. I'll definitely apply it today. Also, let's say I got the job, I got the fellowship, I've applied for the cap-exempt H-1B. And if by any chance I lose my job, the current job which I have, what's the process then? What would be my status then?
If you don't get them to agree and you lose and your EAD runs out?
No, let's say they agree for my cap-exempt H-1B. They file for my concurrent cap-exempt H-1B, and layoffs happen in my current company.
Oh.
What's my status?
Right. So you have about 6 months in the Build Fellowship where you can be on an unpaid leave of absence, but still maintain your status to
okay.
to try to get another employer.
Is that 6 months or 6 weeks? I got
months.
6 months. Okay, great. Great.
Unpaid though. And
correct,
by
yeah.
the way, that's because it's a policy for our organization that any employee, if you're
yep.
part-time or you're full-time, you can have 6 months of unpaid leave if you want to.
Great. Okay. Makes sense. Is there any criteria for fellowship? Do you need any basic qualifications or any field you would need there?
You have to have a degree in the field in which you work. So if you're working
correct.
In
Okay.
Yeah, you need to be working in software if you have a software degree.
Oh, great. Okay. That's all the questions I have. I'll apply the fellowship, and once I get it, I have to start the process with my current employer for them to file the concurrent H-1B.
Exactly.
And what's the percentage of the approval for the cap-exempt H-1B or the fellowship?
99%.
Okay, great.
Yep. I recommend, Srivali, asking your employer
first.
Just saying to them, I have a few months left. I wasn't selected in the lottery. You know this.
Yep.
Will you get on the phone with this organization?
Got it. Oh, okay.
Just will you talk to them with me? And you know, here you can, of course, lay out the scenario. It's a fellowship program. I work 5 hours for them. I get a cap-exempt H-1B. They have a 99% approval rate. Will you just talk to them about this solution? And you know what? let us talk about the price. Let us talk about the program, you know?
Okay, got it. Okay, yes. Makes sense. Do you need any, like, how I will reach out to my immigration team. I'll see if they are ready to, I'm not sure if.
What company do you work for?
Microsoft.
Oh, so yeah, I don't know that it's going to work.
Okay.
Microsoft and these large corporations, just like Deloitte, who the other folks were from, it's they don't do anything like this for their employees because they are very strict with their immigration policies. You can totally, you can bring it up. I think it's worth asking, but the expectation is that it's most likely not going to work. So the other option is doing the, you know, if you have your own company that you have, you could pay for the program yourself.
Okay. Okay. That's a big concept I need to look into. So, or else do you have any list of companies that you were able to succeed?
You can go to our, website. And if you go to the companies page, there's a whole list of companies we've worked with.
Okay, got it. Maybe I'll look that up. I'll also apply as an initial I'll just begin the application. I'll also reach out to the immigration team. Let me see if anything works out. I would love to have an advantage from you. So that's all the questions I have. Thank you for your time.
Okay. No problem. Anybody else have a question? Okay. Vivek, I'm glad you asked that. Everything is remote. So every single fellowship is done remotely. That was a very good question. I'm sorry I didn't cover that.
That's nice to hear.
Yes. Awesome. Anything else?
This is Anil here.
Hi, Anil.
Yeah, hi. I just have a question that what is the validity of this cap-exempt visa, which program which you are doing it?
What is the what?
Validity, like how long it is valid for the cap-exempt. Suppose not getting the H-1B in lotteries, how long we can stay with the cap-exempt H-1B?
Sure. We file a 3-year cap-exempt H-1B because that's the max you can file for any H-1B in the U.S. If the visa, you know, if you win the lottery the next year, you can leave before you hit those 3 years. Right. But if you, you know, need to keep staying in the program, you can stay for 3 years. Or, you know, if you need to extend, you can also have a total of 6 years in H-1B status, same with cap-exempt H-1B. So we have two people ever that have extended beyond 3 years.
Okay. And the initial fee, which is about 15,000 to 18,000, that is paid by the company or whom it is paid by?
It's paid by the company.
Okay.
It could be, if your company says no, it could be your own company. Mm-hmm. So if you had your own company that you started, it could be that company that also pays.
Okay. And the 1350 is about that per month?
1300 per month, yes.
Yes. Okay. That's fine.
Yeah. Cool. So for everyone on the call, please go to our website, www.buildfellowship.com. And at thebuildfellowship.com, you can nominate yourself for the program. You can send your employers to nominate you for the program. It's really important that you can get into that system, try to fill out that form, because then you're going to be able to actually get materials to talk about this to your employer or to move forward and start the process immediately.
Okay, thank you.
Great. All right, everyone. Any last questions? Okay, well, I'm glad you all were here. Thank you so much for coming, and we will be in touch. You can always message me on LinkedIn. Thanks. Bye.